Tonight, a local man is being featured on one of the most popular talk shows in the world.
And see how WSU students are using TikTok. Murrow News 8 starts now.
Broadcasting studios on the campus of Washington State University. This is Murrow News 8.
Good evening. I'm Zach Miller.
And I'm Jasmine Brown. Welcome to Murrow News 8. We've got some interesting weather going on out there. Caitlin Rappel has a little more on that for us.
We certainly do. Today, there is a 30% chance of showers, mainly before 4 p.m., so make sure to pack a raincoat. Along with a chance of rain, it will be very windy with potential gusts as high as 32 miles per hour, so be careful if you're walking places or going to be on the roads. Tonight, there will be a slight chance of snow, but it shouldn't stick too much. Much more with weather in a bit.
WSU Horticultural Club is having a Valentine's Day sale. According to WSU Insider, the Horticultural Club just wrapped up their two-day sale today. The sale lasted from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. and was held at the greenhouses next to Ferdinand's. It included flower pots of tulips, prime roses, and other assortment of flowers. All the proceeds from the sale go to scholarships for the Horticultural Club members.
One of the Palouse's very own will be on TV's Monday. You can catch Brad Briers on The Ellen Show to see what the stuntman and daredevil has to show America. Briers, who currently works for U of I, holds 73 world records for sword swallowing.
In celebration of Black History Month, WSU Black Student Union will sponsor the Vibe Conference, also known as the Visionaries Inspiring Black Empowered Student Conference. The conference starts today, held at the Compton Union Building, and will end on Sunday. According to the Vibe's website, registration is now closed, but more events on the celebration of Black History Month will continue all month long. The next scheduled for BSU will be the film Queen of Slim at 6 p.m. on February 16th.
According to Moscow Pullman Daily News, a task force for WSU Transportation Services is looking for public input on possible raises, fees, and fines on parking campus. The changes would come into effect July 1st, with new fees predicted to increase by as high as $100.
Are textbooks draining our bank accounts? Lucy Fasana has the story.
Every semester, students may be assigned a textbook for a class. And where do they go? To the bookstore on campus. But textbooks can add a hefty charge to a student's bank account, depending on the amount of books they need and the price. According to the College Board, over the course of a year, the average college student spends more than $1,200 on books and materials. And it's not just books that drain your bank account. Access codes for online textbooks come at a large cost as well.
When you have to buy an access code from the bookie, if you go and buy straight from the publisher, it's like $10, $15, maybe $20 cheaper.
Something many students may not know is that the bookie does price match with Amazon.com and BarnesandNoble.com.
So if a student finds a book and they feel that it is, or they see that it is a little overpriced on either of those sites, they can come on in and let us know, hey, it's at a lower price on these sites. We will just confirm that at the time that they're letting us know, and we will match those prices.
According to the College Investor, students go in store to buy a textbook or materials when it's an emergency, urgency, or convenience, not out of necessity. If more students would use the price matching tool, it would give them the convenience of buying their textbooks on campus at a reasonable price. I'm Lucy Fasano, Murrow News 8.
In celebration of National Trio Day, WSU will host a two-day webinar and panel discussion focusing on providing support for first-generation college students. According to WSU Insider, the webinar event is scheduled to take place on Thursday, February 20th, and the panel discussion on Friday, February 21st. Both events will take place in the Cub on the WSU Pullman campus. Times and more information can be found at the WSUinsider.com.
Social media has made a huge impact on this generation, but nothing can compare to the hype around TikTok. Here's what's it all about? Promise Calloway has the story.
TikTok, famously known for its hilarious videos and dance challenges, has taken over this generation. After scrolling on there for an hour, the trend of songs are sure to get stuck in your head. Why don't you say so? This app is for making and sharing short videos. The videos are tall, not square, like on Snapchat or Instagram stories. You navigate through these videos by scrolling up and down like a feed, rather than tapping or swiping side to side.
I would say TikTok is a creative platform of social media. It's more than just sharing your like photos and just things about yourself like Instagram or Facebook. It's more than Vine was, because you were limited to only 7 seconds. You have up to a minute to just be creative in whatever way possible in making a video.
It's been downloaded nearly 80 million times in the United States and almost 800 million times worldwide. So what makes TikTok that much more different than the rest of our social media platforms?
Honestly, I would say that as much fun as TikTok is, it is probably the most addictive of social media platforms. You can really get sucked into watching videos on there. And also, they have it so that you can't see the time at the top of the videos. So like, you could be on there for hours and you wouldn't really even have a concept of time. And I know I'm on there. Like one time I checked my weekly breakdown on my phone and I had spent 16 hours on TikTok in 1 week. And it doesn't go under social media, it goes under creativity in your phone. So I was like, well, creativity? And I was like, oh my God, 16 waking hours in 1 week.
Even with this time-consuming element, social media users continue to be huge TikTok fans with their continuous new dances and challenges. In Pullman, I'm Promise Calloway, Murrow News 8.
And find out what hot name in country music will be in Spokane tomorrow when Murrow News 8 returns.
Me and my boy Matt had it good. He had catnip that was off the hook. But one day, he brings a girl home, and she's allergic to cats. Every sneeze was a nail in my coffin. Now I'm in a shelter. It's decent, but they don't even have Wi-Fi.
Listen, you're my friend.
I noticed you haven't really been yourself recently.
Yeah, I feel like something's up.
How are you?
Are you okay?
Is there anything you want to talk about?
I just want to know how you're feeling.
And listen, even if you don't know what to say, I'm here to talk.
No matter what you're going through,
I just want you to know I'm here.
I've got your back. When you want to talk, I'm here.
Washington State passes a sports gambling bill. According to the Seattle Times, the Washington State of the House of Representatives voted 83-14 in favoring of allowing sports gambling in state tribal casinos. The bill limits sports gambling to 29 tribal casinos in the state. Legislators hope the bill can reach Governor Jay Inslee's desk by spring. The Washington State has voted to ban hair discrimination. According to the spokesman review, the bill makes it so workers won't have to cut or change their hairstyle. The bill passed with a vote of 87 to 10 as it gets sent into Senate.
A man out of Grant County is being charged with animal cruelty and possession of illegal drugs. According to the Spokesman Review, 56-year-old Raimundo Garcia had 13 roosters that were physically modified for fighting and had methamphetamine, heroin, cocaine, and other drugs in his possession. The investigation is ongoing to find the other people involved in the fighting ring. Around 100 people have accepted separation and early retirement from the University of Idaho. According to the Moscow Pullman Daily News, the moves come as the university tries to cut $22 million out of the next year's budget. The current early retirement is expected to save the university around $8.7 million, but some of the positions that will be opened up have to be filled. Blake Shelton is scheduled to be in Spokane tomorrow in the showcase for his Friends and Heroes 2020 tour. The tour is scheduled to include the Bellamy brothers, John Anderson, Lauren Elena, and Trace Atkins. The tour starts at 7 p.m. and will be held at the Spokane Arena.
What does Valentine's Day look like for a local florist? Our reporter Kirsten Rosser has the story.
Valentine's Day has arrived, and local family-owned Neal's Flowers is getting ready for their busiest day of the year. Neal's has been on Main Street for almost 100 years, serving the town of Pullman since 1920. This year, the flowers were ordered in October to make sure there were enough for the town of Pullman to get their orders in. Once delivered, they stay hydrated and cooled to keep them to the highest quality.
Valentine's Day is quickly approaching, and with a small town community in Pullman, Washington, locals can count on Neal's Florists, as you can see behind me, for their Valentine's Day needs.
My family took over Neal's Flowers. My dad started working here in 1972, so he's doing his 48th Valentine's Day here at Neal's Flowers, and he's owned it for 42 of those Valentine's Days. Valentine's Days and Mother's Days are generally the busiest holidays for the single event. Valentine's Day is definitely the busiest. We'll do 400 to 500 deliveries on Valentine's Day. We'll have four vans out running from about 8 in the morning until they get done. Friday should be pretty good. We'll work most of through the night on Thursday night, making sure everything's ready to be delivered, and then we'll still have plenty of time to take care of anybody that calls and still needing something delivered or want to come in and pick something up on Friday.
The chaos of the week started on Wednesday with the outpour of calls that were coming in. The hard work continues until Friday night once all of the flowers are delivered.
This is Chris Chandler from Neal's Flowers. Happy Valentine's Day.
And with Murrow News 8, I'm Kirsten Rosser.
Don't go anywhere. Your national news updates are coming up.
And what's going on with the weather? Caitlin Rappel has more on that when we come back.
Find her.
Your hero needs you now, and AARP is here to help. Find the care guides you need at aarp.org/caregiving.
There. Can I tell you a cat joke? Just kidding.
Why did the girl ask the mushroom to dance?
Because he was a fun guy.
What do you call a pig that knows karate?
Pork chop.
Why was the basketball court all wet?
Why?
Because the players kept dribbling all over it.
Can I tell you another one? So
how does a tissue dance?
Put a little boogie on it.
What's Beethoven's favorite fruit?
Banana.
What is a boxer's favorite drink?
Fruit punch.
Welcome back to Murrow News 8. Caitlin, what's our weather looking like today?
Thanks, guys. Well, today we're looking at a high of 43 with a low of 32. There is a little bit of a chance for rain, so just to be safe, bring a jacket if you're going to be out. Moving on to tomorrow, we have a high of 39 and 34, and we will see more precipitation tomorrow. It will be a little bit more wet than it is today. Looking at the state map, we have Seattle and Olympia about the same. Both are rainy, so if you are planning to travel to the west side this weekend, I would say be careful, watch the roads, they might be a little bit slick. Yakima, sunny and 50 degrees, which is pretty high for this time of the year. Tri-City is about the same, still 54 and sunny. Pullman and Spokane, the same, both are with the similar highs, both rain-snow mixture. And then looking at our five-day forecast, Friday, rain and snow, Saturday, rain and snow, Sunday, rain and snow. So you can see those all look the same, and that is because we are having a storm system that comes this weekend. Now that will arrive in two waves. The first one will arrive tonight and into Saturday morning. The second one will arrive later into Saturday with the heaviest precipitation overnight into Sunday. But as you can see, we warm up. Well, that's all from weather. Back to you guys at the desk.
A person in San Juan County is showing symptoms of the coronavirus. King 5 reports that 25 people have been tested in Washington State. Of those, 23 tested negative with one testing positive. The CDC has administered the test on the person in San Juan, and we should have the results within 48 hours. A woman is facing a lawsuit after escaping a hospital ward where she was under quarantine for the coronavirus. According to CNN, Ayla Liana returned to St. Petersburg after she was put under observation at the Boykin Hospital. After being quarantined for the mandatory 14 days, Liana short-circuited the lock on her door and fled the hospital. The health authorities are pursuing the lawsuit for the endangering the public.
A bill to reduce the punishment for polygamy is on the way to the Utah Senate. NPR reports that the bill's main sponsor, Senator Deidre Henderson, believed that the, quote, vigorous enforcement of the law during the mid-20th century did not deter the practice of plural marriage, end quote. To put in simple terms, this bill would change polygamy from a felony offense to an infraction, on par with a traffic ticket. This bill needs support from the full chamber to be put into practice. In world news, according to CNN, Sudan said it signed a deal to settle claims related to the bombing of USS Cole. The guided missile destroyer was attacked on October 12, 2000 after it entered the port of Aden in Yemen. To refuel, the signed deal could end lawsuits filed. Could end lawsuits filed by victims and their families and also improve Sudan's chances of getting off the U.S. list of state sponsors of terrorism.
ABC News reports that a senior Senate Department official says the U.S. reached an agreement to reduce violence with the Taliban. According to ABC News, this may continue a previous deal to end conflict in Afghanistan altogether. The deal would see U.S. forces to withdraw from Afghanistan completely while the Taliban must speak with other Afghans to negotiate peace. As of this morning, the deal will not completely end for fighting, the senior officials told ABC that it's nationwide. The Trump administration plans to continue building the wall along the southern border. Where is the money coming from? It could be coming out of the Defense Department's budget. NPR reports that the Trump administration plans to use nearly $4 million of the defense budget to build the wall. Remember, this is only a request and no money has been moved. It will need to be passed through Congress to hold merit.
Valentine's Day is here, and we know some of you may not be feeling in the holiday spirit, but hopefully you were able to celebrate the day where you don't have to feel excluded just because you may not have that special someone quite yet.
To many, the tradition of Valentine's Day is a Hallmark holiday, a day that is solely about commercialization in order to profit off of it. To people like Washington State University student McKenna Kendall, it's kind of a scam.
Well, Valentine's Day to me is just like a day about love and just like loving one another, but it's really turned into almost like who can spend the most money.
The celebration of Valentine's Day spotlights love and being in a relationship, but that tends to leave a lot of people reflecting on their being alone.
Well, I'm okay with being single because, I mean, I'm young, I'm still finding myself, and I mean, I surround myself with people who love me. I don't feel like I need to be in a relationship, and it's definitely events like this that make you feel so like you're not the only person who's in that boat.
Lucky for Kendall, there is a day that the Brelsford WSU Visitor Center chose to celebrate instead this year, Galentine's Day. The event had wine tasting, food, friends, and fun.
Love is about more than just romantic love. There's all kinds of love. There's, you know, sibling love, family love, and then friendship love. And I think Galentine's Day is really just about celebrating that type of love.
Galentine's Day isn't exclusive to just the gals. Men, women, singles, couples, friends, everyone is welcome. Galentine's Day is just a day to celebrate with those you love most.
We just felt like it was a really fun opportunity to celebrate friendship, to celebrate the Cougar family, and to not make it feel exclusive to only romantic love.
So whether you are married, dating, or single, Valentine's and Galentine's Day are meant to be about spreading and making people feel love. With Murrow News 8, I'm Sophia Canton.
Cougar Athletic has quite the weekend lineup. Kirsten Rosser has your sports update when we return.
My mother was always very familiar with her neighborhood, but one day she stopped at the stop sign for much longer than usual, and she didn't know whether she should go forward or turn, and she wasn't even really sure where she was at. It was very unsettling for her.
I felt so much better after my son told me, Mom, I don't want you to worry or be afraid. I'll be there for you and we'll figure it out.
This is the story of a boy who didn't talk for a long time. The boy liked things to always be the same. Any changes would scare and upset him. The unknown was an unfriendly place. The boy was very sensitive to lights and sounds. So he built secret hiding places where they couldn't get in. The boy didn't like looking people in the eye. He wasn't trying to be mean, it just made him feel uncomfortable. Sometimes he would flap his arms again and again.
One day I found out I have something called autism. My family got me help. Slowly, I found my voice and learned all the way I could live with it better.
Early intervention can make a lifetime of difference. Learn the signs at autismspeaks.org.
Me and my boy Matt had it good. He had catnip that was off the hook. But one day, he brings a girl home and she's allergic to cats. Every sneeze was a nail in my coffin. Now I'm in a shelter. It's decent, but they don't even have Wi-Fi.
WSU men's basketball fell short to UCLA last night. The game ended 86-83 with the Cougars losing in overtime. In the final two possessions of the game, the defense had a meltdown, which is something that has repeatedly happened during away games this season. Coach Smith in a post-game interview said, quote, "If you had told me we would have Bonton 3-point shot for the win while tied on the road here, I'll take it," end quote. Women's basketball heads down to Arizona to play the Sun Devils in a 6 p.m. Pacific time tip-off. Friday's game is the 66th meeting between the two. The last WSU victory over ASU was in January of 2014.
On Sunday, the women will move on to play University of Arizona Wildcats in Tucson. The last time these two teams met was in Pullman on January 17, 2020. The Cougs lost 77-74. Tip-off is Sunday at 1 a.m. Pacific Time. WSU baseball has their season opener today away at Cal State University Bakersfield. The game will take place at 6 p.m. Pacific Time and will be web-streamed. There will also be a play on Saturday at 1 p.m. and Sunday at 12 p.m. before heading back to Pullman. With new head coach Brian Green, Coug fans are hopeful for a strong season. The track and field distance squad will be competing in the Husky Classic today and tomorrow in Seattle. The rest of the track team has been competing in the Don Kirby Elite in Albuquerque, New Mexico. The team started yesterday and will continue today all day. Cody Bellinger, LA Dodgers first baseman and reigning National League MVP, did not hold back this morning when commenting on the Houston Astros' sign-stealing methods and their apologies. According to ESPN, Bellinger said, quote, "I thought their apologies were whatever. I thought Jim Crane's was weak. I thought Manfred's punishment was weak. Those guys were cheating for 3 years," end quote. The Washington Redskins are releasing cornerback Josh Norman. Norman said that the new Redskins coach Ron Rivera, who coached him in Carolina, called him this morning to inform him on the release. This move was expected as it would save the Redskins $12.5 million, which is money that will be used to sign a new cornerback. And yesterday, New Orleans Pelican Zion Williamson finished with a career-high 32 points in the Pelicans' loss to Oklahoma City. According to ESPN, Williamson, who is 19 years old, became the fourth teenager in NBA history to have a consecutive 30-point game. And yesterday, Seattle Mariners' Mitch Haniger had his second surgery in just 3 weeks. A source told ESPN that the surgery was on Haniger's back. The first surgery took place in January, and it was to fix a core muscle injury. These setbacks mean that Haniger will not be recovered by the time opening day is upon us. And here's something that Coug fans might like to hear. The UW men's basketball team lost to USC yesterday on the road. This is the Huskies' seventh straight loss. They go to play UCLA Saturday night.
Coming up, can't buy me love, or can you? We'll tell you all about a Valentine's Day auction next on Murrow News 8.
You can achieve a lot using your imagination. I mean, I don't like to brag, but... Wait, who's that? And why is she all over these achievement awards?
But with STEM, the sky's the limit.
Shaboom!
Use STEM to envision.
Okay, I'm seeing it. Yeah.
Invent.
Got any ideas?
I've got a few, actually. And create a better world.
Told you she's super smart.
If she can STEM, so can you. Find out more at SheCanSTEM.
It's okay to be scared. You don't have to be so strong.
Strength is not optional. This is my mother, my purpose. Real muscle is lifting her spirits between bedpans and bad news from doctors that doubt her strength. Strength is buried in bills, managing meds, and swallowing those moments of, "Mom, it's me, your daughter." Remember? My strength is super, but I'm still human, right?
Look who's here. There she is. Thanks for your patience.
How you feeling?
If you're caring for a loved one, visit aarp.org/caregiving for care guides and community, or call 1-877-333-5885.
Thanks for watching.
And good night.